Right, everybody, hello and welcome back. We're back here in the cockpit. We have filled up with some fuel and I'm just going to turn on the information, turn on the master switch here to see what the fuel is. And we're up at about, what is that, between 15 and 30. So 20 odd gallons, 23 gallons in there, 23 gallons in there. So that's not too shabby at all. We have a nice day outside really for flying. We're not going to be getting up that high. I haven't done the weather. We're here in Bristol. There's not much activity going on in here at all, which is what it is. A couple of aircraft parked over there on the apron, and nothing else going on here at all really, which is what it is. So we are going to just get on with it, I suppose. Get the fuel pump going up, see if we can get the fuel pressure rising. And I see the fuel pressure is rising quite nicely. So that's okay. We will get a couple of pumps going in. Fuel mixture rich. Get that going in. Turn on a beacon here to say that there's somebody alive. And then you'd open the window and you'd say, get away from the prop, clear prop, as I suppose would be the normal process. We'll close that. And brakes are on, we give her a start. She kicks over quite quickly. Run it up to about 1,000 revs. And we are good. We don't have any external fuel in there. We'll stick in our whatchamacallums. I've also made a little bit of a change to my radio stack and all the rest. Namely, that we don't actually have the GPS in here anymore. It was just a bit of a personal choice just to get rid of it, to be honest with you. Master avionics can go on. Autopilot is already on. 113.5 won that, and 114.05. Yes, I have been playing around with this already. We will set that there. So there are our three numbers. We'll switch that one back over. So this is our standby 117. This here is going to be our first one as we get over towards Southampton, and we will turn that on to a distance once we take off. Good. That's all in. We'll close that off. And we are not looking too shabby at all. Our track is going to take us out to the east predominantly. And we do have some information actually on that piece of paper that I wish I had printed it out. I really will have to start organizing myself a little bit better so that we can just be a little bit more efficient in here. But we're waiting for temperatures to rise, and we're not going to do a bit of a run up here. We'll go elsewhere to do that, but I am going to zoom in on this picture that I took and get some directions of travel. I didn't actually get that piece of information, which was a bit dumb. A dum dum da 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 dum da dum dum. Not very clever. But that's okay. We have magnetic variance on the VOR and the DME and all the rest that we'll have to get into at a later stage. Right now, we are with our landing flaps. We're going to make sure that they're all the way up. Fuel down here, we're selected on both of those. We'll take off the brake, check around to say thanks to the lads, and we'll just get ourselves moving nice and slowly here. We will turn on our landing lights just to make sure that everything is boo-tickety. I'm not setting a squawk, I'm not talking to radio control, I'm not doing any of that malarkey. We're just going to head up here towards the end of the runway and turn around and do a takeoff and get flying. Because that's what it's all about at the moment. I just feel like getting flying. And we'll put in a little bit of respect toward the normal processes, but it'll only be a little bit. This is certainly not a video that you should be watching if you're looking for proper flying instruction. But this is a video that you should watch, because it is going to demonstrate awesome simulation flying potential still with Flight Simulator X on an i5 processor running 4.2 GHz, so it is slightly upticked in terms of its overclock. I do have a 1080 GTX graphics card in here, which has not so much of an effect for Flight Simulator X. It's mostly a CPU dependent piece of software. I am running Orbix scenery, and I do have Rex weather. For my sins, I have been battling these pieces of software for pretty much, I suppose, the last couple of hours, or even longer, as I did have some tissues and some issues. Most of that was down to my sliders, and some of it was down to some changes to the flight or the FSX configuration file. I'm just leaning over here to grab a piece of paper that I have printed off, which is Costa's Flight Simulation FSX Guidance. Now, I had another FSX config tweak that I had done, and I was very pleased with. But in Costa's version, there were a couple of things that were changed. And I do intend to put up a quick video just showing the before and after effects, and making reference to Costa's tweaks as well. They were very much worth it, and I certainly feel that I've benefited on my little computer from doing that. We're using TrackIR to look around. The aircraft is the A2A Comanche, of course. And generally, the sim seems to be doing okay at the moment here. I need a cup of coffee or something, I think. Anyway, we're coming out to the threshold here as we navigate our way down, keeping the needle pretty much pinned. It hasn't registered a speed yet. And we're looking to see if we're clear to cross the hold markers when we get to them. We need to look the other way down the runway as well now. Wind socks are not doing anything. So we have the choice of taking off whichever direction we wish. So we're choosing to take off here, and I'm going to make the decision to cross those markers and line up runway 9. So this is perfect. Lights. Just for ease and purpose, we'll turn that on. Mixture is rich. Fuel is in. We'll set flaps. We have a problem, which we don't want to be fixing here. I have a flap problem. That's why you do checklists. I will be back in a moment. you look over here, we've got a flap problem. I'm not going to stop on the runway. We're going to taxi our way back off the runway over here. ATC would be being told right now that we're not going anywhere, that we do have a stuck flap, which we're not happy about. And we're only noticing it now because we didn't check it earlier. Because, well, we're not being that particular. And that has gone and cost me now quite a bit. So, lesson learned, or not learned, but lesson there to be learned. Do your run-ups, do your checks. Particularly when you're flying this aircraft. Because... She's pretty realistic. I'll bring you back in when I get this fixed. Hello and welcome back. We've had our flap sorted out. It is dropping down now and it's okay on the other side. And we've checked all our other controls and we have fixed that problem. We did have a jammed left wing flap, which the maintenance guys needed to come and sort out. So, don't know what the cause of that was, but it's fixed, so we're good to go again. That is the realism that comes in with the A2A aircraft. I can only recommend it. But it does really drive home the point that this kind of jumping in and flying, cowboy-style simulation flying, is, it's a bit of a joke. What I'm doing is a bit silly. If I'm not going to actually show through respect to the simulation. But anyway, we are about to go. We're rolling straight down the line. I'm going to pull that, and then we're going to apply in some power. Try and keep it down the line. Airspeed is alive. Centerline Pride has gone to the right. Back on the stick. Back on the yoke. Gear up. Flying out the runway. Flaps up. And we're going to be at 2,000 feet at least. Depending on how high the clouds are, we might just stay underneath. Goodbye, Bristol. 1,000. Airspeed is looking good. We are on the search for a signal of 113.3. We're generally going to be flying to the east. We will turn off. For a moment here, we'll turn off those, we'll turn on our Pitot 8 just for good measure, and then we're going to bring the engine back. I like to fly around the 22, 21 and a bit mark. And then we're going to try and lean the engine out just a little bit. That's about as much as I think I can lean out at this altitude up here. We are getting our SAM code coming through. We're kind of trimmed out fairly okay here. Gear's up. Flaps are up. And if we set that to distance, we can put that back in. Get our zoom level a little bit better. That's good. We have 54 miles to track, and if we turn this around, we will see that we're actually not too bad on our track either. I that's kind of the track we're going to be going on. Not sure what the wind is, but that is the track that we're going on, so we can stick that heading on and see how we get on that particular heading. We are climbing ever so slightly still, so I'm just going to trim back down a little bit. Configuration is nice and clean, engine burn is not too bad, temperatures are all looking good, and we're 50 miles away from Sam. We do need to arrest our climb. A little bit. 2,000 feet minimum, we're up at 3,000. I think that's not too bad. We can try and hold on there. And in fact, we can switch on an altitude hold, which will tell us that we need to trim down a little bit more, surely. And then that'll level us off here, which is nice and good. Still need to trim down a little bit, okay. And this is the view outside, which is not too shabby looking compared to what it was looking like before. It's our trim. Bring our trim down to neutral and see what it says. Airspeed has come up to about 160, which is what I would expect. And just back up on that a little bit more. And I'm going to see if I can trim fuel just slightly more for efficiency, which puts us, if we look over here, in terms of US gallons per hour, we're a little bit less than 11, which I think we can probably improve on that if we had some more altitude. We're holding steady just underneath 3,000 feet. We haven't zeroed out our altimeters or anything. We're not going to be going above cloud. And we're just going to stay flying along here, nice and handy. 48 miles, or excuse me, what would that be? I think it's miles, is it? Nautical miles, yeah, it's not miles. It's 48 nautical miles. And of course we're holding 117 on standby. So we're tracking on 113.35 at the moment. We have 117 dialed into the NAV2, which will start showing up on here once we get fairly close to it. But right now we've got the flags up. And other than that, everything is boom-tickety. And we can afford to look out the L window here and enjoy the scenery of Orbix, which I have to say I'm pleased with now. It's taken a while to tweak and to tidy up and to work out what I'm supposed to be doing. It's taken a bit too long, you might argue. But I've been flying the Viggen with 54 Squadron quite a bit recently. I've been flying the Tiger on DCS as well with Wardog. The Viggen has been with Fat Ben's campaign. Phil is doing some Spitfire campaign as well, which unfortunately I'm not available to fly as much as I would like. In fact, I haven't flown any mission on that, although it has been delayed and rain checked and cancelled a couple of times as well, so it hasn't been necessarily always running. Maybe once Ben's campaign is over, in the new year, there'll be a little bit more time to get in and start flying others. Of course, there's the Sabre as well, which is a plane we all like very much. And there are problems arriving for 54 Squadron, good problems, one would say, in the form of the emergence of both NF-14 and a Harrier jump jet. There's significant interest in both of those aircraft, in addition to what we're already flying. My focus is going to remain flying the Viggen, at least. least for the remainder of this year. There's so much to be done with the Vegan. And campaign-wise, Ben's campaign is really putting the stretch on. You will see the autogen loading in as we fly over here. That is for kind of performance reasons. I've had to make a compromise. There's an injection of weather as well, which is something we're just going to have to accept happens as we go along. But the autogen kind of building in as it goes along at the low altitude down here is something that I've just had to accept. I haven't really put the level of detail distance out that far. When we're looking down out in front of the wing here or behind the wing, the image that I'm getting of the scenery is really rather quite nice. And it blends acceptably into the distance that I'm not disturbed by it. Although occasionally up front you can see that there's a chunk of trees or stuff that auto-populate in. But the issue of having blurry underlay has so far disappeared. And to be honest with you, this is the first flight that I'm taking in any kind of anger, just to see how it stays populating. But anyway, back into the cockpit for a moment to look at what's going on. We're 4.6 hours on the old, meter. Hour meter. We're holding fairly decent both manifold pressure and RPM. That RPM needle is wavering around a little bit, but it's not too bad. There's no noticeable vibrations here in the cockpit anyway. And in terms of our track, we're about 120 degrees. We do have a magnetic deviation, so you know, 120, it's 121. It's only a 1 degree kind of thing. Passing over should be able to tell you what that is. I don't want to be silly and say that it's Salisbury's plane, but I think it is, isn't it? I know there's certain parts of it you can walk around on, which I'm sure I've been on, but anyway. We'll stay looking out this way and say nothing, family. There's a huge big ball patch anyway in the ground, which is looking fine. It's all feeding in quite well. Airspeed today is about 155 miles per hour indicated, that is, so it's about 135 knots. And we're not pushing it too hard. We could improve on that a little bit, I suppose. I am keen to look at what our burn rate for fuel is and learn a little bit more of the characteristics of that. Frame rates are holding fairly steady at the capped 30 frames per minute, although that will be rendered out to a different frame rate in the video. And hopefully the video is going to show up as clear as that. Temperature OAT is just under minus here at the moment. The weather is today's weather at the moment as per Rex. So I don't know how accurate exactly that is, but with a little bit of a minus temperature up here and cloud in the area, I'm going to keep a little bit of an eye on my manifold pressure. And you know what? We're just passing 10:15. At 15 seconds, I'm going to pull the carb heat here and give it a minute of carb heat. So we pull the carb heat now. This will reduce the power in the engine a little bit. Might get a little bit of a note on our trim to say we need to trim up slightly, and the end effect will be that it slows down a little bit as well. But what we're doing with the carb heat here is redirecting hot air through a different routing over the carburetor to ensure that there's no ice buildup on the carburetor, which would essentially reduce the performance of our engine. if there is a nice build-up. And ultimately, it'll cause us bigger problems. We'll lose power. Ultimately, we'll lose the engine. So that's coming up on 1 minute of carb heat usage. And you can see that our speed has slowed down to just a smidgen over 150. But we've not changed our pitch. I think we've got enough capacity within our trim that we've, and the autopilot is doing the work anyway, I suppose, so I can't even claim that. Although my trim is relatively well set. Right, that's a minute and a half coming up on the 9 now. I'm watching this gauge here. So we'll call that carb heat back in. And that's okay. These older machines require this kind of handling, and I don't know what the official rules are. It is something that I'll probably look and get a little bit more detail on in the footer, but for the short term purpose of this particular video, we'll be using a little bit of carb heat every so often. Navigation lights I never turned on, so we'll just turn those on. That's probably going to be appreciated. As we fly along, we're drifting a little bit on the north side of our track, but only by almost nothing. I don't know what the wind is going to be doing as we track across here. We're 25.9 and reducing from getting to our first VOR DME, at which point in time we're going to take a turn to the southeast and head down toward the coast. And then along the coast to our third VOR DME, just shy of coming into land. And I should have got an angle, a bearing from the last VOR to get a QFE as well, or a Q&H, I suppose. We do have an airfield down there. If I had my charts printed out and sorted out properly, I'd be able to tell you what that is, but I haven't. There's a cloud coming just over the wing here, so we're very close to our limit in terms of our visual, our visual flight rules. And of course we're supposed to be keeping an eye out for other aircraft in that area as well. Now I've just realized that Just Flight are working on a version 2 of the Vulcan Bomber X-558, so it will be with a lot of interest that I'll be following the development of that also in Flight Simulator X. There's always new aircraft models coming out, and there's a handful of them that I'm particularly interested in. Spitfire, of course, is on that list. This aircraft was a find that hadn't really originally been on my list, but it's kind of the only aircraft that I'm going to be flying general aviation-wise now, because it's just the superior model, and it's got so much going on for it. The Vulcan, I have the Iris Vulcan, which is a fantastic model. It's very, very good. I quite like it. I don't fly it a huge amount, and I don't think I'd be flying the Just Flight one, but I think the Iris model at the moment is the better of the two, just based on what I've seen. And better is subjective, by the way. So it will be with a little bit of interest. I'll be looking to see what 2018 brings with the updated version of the Just Flight model. But I really do hope they go down a full simulation tact with it and really make it a proper aircraft simulation, and not just another kind of piece of payware that is fine, but not much better than okay a little bit. Now this needle has jumped around here. I'm going to pull this and see, do we have a NAV2 beacon being picked up? I've just noticed this needle passed over there. We've got NAV flag and the glide slope flag still on. The scenery outside is looking lovely. I'm very pleased with Orbix products, and I've been purchasing quite a few of them now. Getting them set up is probably going to be an easy enough experience. It takes a while to download and whatnot. I think I've made life a little bit hard on myself because I have had other software, other scenery and so on and so forth loaded, and I don't think I was keeping things as clean and as tidy as I should. We are 15 nautical miles away. We're a little bit north of our track. Now, that is NAV2 radio picking up south. What was the second one? If we had our Morse, we'd be able to go ahead and identify what all of that is as well. Gosh, I really made a bad example of photographing that. Break the rules here for a minute and I'll take another photograph. This is a black screen at the moment for you, and I do apologize, but we're just going to quickly take that photograph, jump back in, and we're back on flight. And what I've done is I've taken another photograph of what I showed in the start of the video. So this is SFD, whatever SFD means. But it is 117 with 0.4 of a deviation, a minus deviation on magnetic variability. So we'll be tracking that in. We're 12, just gone to 11.9 nautical miles on our current track towards SAM, I want to say. Then we have SFD, and then we have LYD. So we're just going to say yeah to that. We don't need to track that anymore. And I'm going to turn my to see if we can pick up where we're supposed to be going here. We have to get past 100. There. So that's going to be tracking on a course that is pointing up at about 100 and maybe 104, 105 degrees. We are tracking ever so slightly north of that, so I'm going to make a little bit of an adjustment just to split the difference there. We're only 10 nautical miles out, so it's not going to be much of a big deal. That's probably going to come in really quite quickly now. But as we see this number going down, what I'll do is I'll switch over 117, and I will readjust our course then to match what it's showing here. So this is 90 degrees, 100 degrees, 110, 120, and we're just between the two, so it's maybe maybe 105 or 106 or something in there. I don't know. It's getting a bit hazy up here as well, but we're doing all right. Now the other thing we can do is we can set our clock, and then we can time our legs for our indicated airspeed, and make an understanding of what we, you know, what we expect to see under our wing when we get, you know, when we get to a particular location after traveling at that speed for so long. This is obviously Southampton that we're coming over, so that kind of makes sense. We have the runway in front of us and we're going to be flying directly over it. So that's all very well and good. You can see the Docklands down there. So far, so okie dokie. The other thing is that this needle is going to start not being lined up now. I'm not going to try and chase it. I haven't been chasing it on the flight so far. In fact, in terms of wind, we haven't really been suffering anything. It's very, very calm, at least so far. It was calm in Bristol when we took off. But this center section of the needle now is going to start swinging its way out to the left or the right. And this arrow, once we pass in another 3 or so nautical miles, this arrow and the basically this instrument is going to become unreliable, and the arrow is actually going to flip over, and then the needle will come back in, and that distance will start going back up again, and it'll tell us, because the triangle is pointing up at the moment, we're going towards that, and we're 2.9 nautical miles away, and if we look out over the nose, we'll be able to see something, I suppose, 2.9 nautical miles. This is now drifting all the way up to the left here. As we get closer and closer, we're essentially not going to be able to trust this anymore. But for fun, I'm just going to stay on this track for a little bit longer until this flips over. Currently pointing to, and it'll flip over to traveling from in about a nautical mile. And then we'll have to set up our track again. So that's already out here now to the left and in full. So if we were to try and chase this around, we'd end up going around in a circle because we're basically just over the VOR right now. So it's done its job. We are where we expect to be. Just passed over Southampton. We can see Southampton is there. Where are we going to next? We'll either have a visual to the airport that we're going to land, or in our case, we're going to be moving on to our next VOR DME. You'll see now that the arrow has pointed away from, so we're traveling away from it, and our distance is increasing again. So we were 0.8, we're now 1.1. So we've basically passed the VOR now, and we're traveling away from it. And we can actually use that as a navigation system as well, because we can say, well, we need to travel on a particular course, a certain distance, away from a location. That's another way for us to find out where we are. It's not just to. We can do it from as well. But anyway, that's done its job. We are now going to switch over to 117. And the arrow goes to. And we are very much south of the course, so we are going to change things around a little bit until we get ourselves in on track, which looks like we might be there. And now we're just going to turn our heading onto that. The aircraft is going to turn because we are on autopilot. And we're going to essentially track around here. It's a VOR, but it's a DME as well, a distance measuring equipment included in the radio signal. So we can tell that we are 53.4 nautical miles from it, 53.3. So the arrow is 2. Our distance is reducing. We're feeling fairly good about this. So the next thing that I'm going to dial in here is it's set that up here as well, actually. Get it right, Jack. 14.05. So we can set that up and pick that up on the second, on this ADI here as well, or on this, whatever this is. What is that? That is the ADI, isn't it? This is HSI. And this here is an ADI. Tooltips, where are you? Don't forsake me. Omni bearing selector knob. Anyway, we are heading across England nice and lovely. Now we do have, you know, big airports up in this direction up here. We're going to stay kind of close enough to the southern coast here. We're not observing restrictions or following proper flight procedures per se. We're just doing a fun VFR flight just to get me back into the swing of things kind of properly here. But I am satisfied that the scenery is updating itself and it's all looking fairly decent outside. And of course we're enjoying the fact that we're flying along here in this A2A Comanche without too many problems. It was kind of cool that we had that little flap problem earlier, and slightly uncool that I hadn't done my checklists and found it. But, you know, there's an opportunity there to really truly understand what's going on and why checklists are important. That is the South Coast as we track along past Southampton here. And we have the Isle of Wight just kind of in the view there at the back. So from old clips of Dover and flying with 54 Squadron and prior to that 92 Squadron, we'll have flown around this territory a lot, an awful lot. Almost enough that it kind of feels like I know my way around here just looking out the window. However, the map from the 1940s looks quite a little bit different in the modern era here. So it is still possible to get lost because some of the fields, particularly around here, are no longer on the map. They've been taken over. Some of them are housing estates, I suppose. But it is kind of cool to be flying over an area of ground that you recognize the major features of from a completely different sim, completely different era of flying Hurricanes, Mark 1s and Mark 2 Spitfires. Temperatures are still cold. I've been keeping an eye on the old manifold pressure here and things are holding up quite nicely on it, so I don't think we have any major tissues to worry about in terms of temperature. But I don't think it's any harm for us to just pull that out on the 9 and we'll follow it around all the way back to the 3. That'll just make sure that we don't have any ice buildup. It is modelled in this aircraft, so if you're flying in rain and you're in cold weather, you will have problems. The degree of fidelity here with this A2A Comanche, it leaves me behind because you really need to print off your flight checklists and your procedures and properly implement them to truly extract the value out of this simulation. And talk is cheap, and I keep saying I'm going to do that and I don't. So we'll have to do some work to fix that up. It's past, so we've got another 30 seconds with which to burn off and melt any ice build up or knock it back if there is any. And we'll do that again a little bit later on. The weather from Rex is working out quite well. I've reduced a lot of the demand in terms of textures. I've reduced that right down. I think the tendency is to go for the nicest and the most awesome. But the reality is that there aren't too many computers out there that are really going to be able to do it fully justice. I'm running an i5 overclocked to 4.2 GHz, 16 GB of RAM, which, you know, I, it's not going to make too much of a difference for Flight Simulator X, because it's still a 32-bit program at the end of the day, and the out-of-memory error is something that is a concern. It's always going to plague. It's always going to plague us. So we're just going to have to fly our legs and reset the sim and carry on. But with all of that said and done, between the tweaks and experience and lessons learned and all the rest, a lot can still be achieved with this simulation. So generally fairly pleased. Fuel-wise, we're going along here quite nicely. We're still kind of 10.5 gallons per hour. They're US gallons, by the way. I've set everything to feet and miles and standard miles, nautical miles, gallons. That's the way I'm talking, and that's the way I'm going to stay talking. So. Leave the metric for other aircraft. Huge big discussions sometimes over why it's still imperial and in metric in this world, which that's the way it is. You can talk till the cows come home, but it's not going to make a lick of difference. Now, I did take out the GPS, and I took it out predominantly for performance reasons originally. And to be honest with you, I've decided to leave it out. For this vintage of aircraft and GPS, we can always put a plug-in handheld GPS model into the aircraft afterwards, I suppose. But I'm not going to use GPS. I'm going to rely on flying without GPS and without any of the modern fancy. There are two options of GPS to put in here. You will see down here that my GPS is set to in-op, and the switch there is down on nav only. That's because we don't actually have the GPS installed either in the instrumentation stack here or over in the green area beside the passenger, in front of the passenger. There's a possibility to put up another Garmin version GPS as well, which I've also chosen not to do. We are a little bit south of track here at 33 nautical miles. If we pull our nav to ident, we are already picking up limb, which kind of makes sense. And what are we doing there? We have 83.2. 82.2. So that's actually giving us a range, a target range distance measurement as well. So we're 32 from SFD or whatever it is, and we're 82 from LIM. So that's actually pretty cool. I didn't realize that was the feature that was operating here, but clearly it is. Standby frequency bar. Interesting. I didn't realize it did that at all. Cool. I need to fly this more and pick up all the features that are going on. Anyway, there's the south coast as we're ticking along. There's Wilmington. And Dungeness Point is just beginning to show itself on the horizon over there through the haze. You won't be able to see it very clearly just yet, but we'll be flying fairly close and over to it. Tracking ever so slightly south, so I'm just going to put in a little bit of a counter there, just a little bit. Just so that we arrest that deviation a little bit. So the channel over which we've virtually flown quite a bit, and in DCS, the Normandy map in DCS allows us the southern coast of England with which to fly around on as well, so we get to go over and back on the channel. The DCS World War II offering is still quite immature. There's a little bit more to go on and a little bit more to do in order to make it, you know, a proper World War II simulation. But it's getting there. It's just not there yet. I'm looking to see, are they lights that are turning on the road? And I kind of think they are. Well, you can see the motorways are beginning to get lit up. Evening time, it's 4 o'clock. Interesting. 80 miles away from Lim, 80 nautical that is. Running along here at 155 still, so we're ticking along quite nicely. Fuel burn is okay, fuel is fine. Temperatures, pressures, and amps are okay. We're not producing any amps, but we're not using any either. Altitude is relatively stable at just 2900 feet indicated. So that's all very good. We are drifting a little bit south, so I am going to cheat a little bit here and just throw in a little bit of turn just to chase that needle a little bit. Now you would do that over a course of time if you were dealing with wind, and we might be dealing with wind over here, of course. The wind will push you off, so you need to nose into the wind a little bit in order to offset that the push of the wind, if you like. So where the nose of the aircraft is pointing may not necessarily be where the aircraft is going, because it'll be being slipped through the air because of the wind pushing on the side of it. I think that's something that it's learnable, it's understandable, it's explainable, but it's also something that takes a little bit of experience to tune in on. To make it a little bit better. I'm just going to turn this a little bit to get an idea of the course heading that we would be doing if we were going to go direct from here towards Lim. And that looks like a course heading of 075. Shoreham is there. The airfield has got an airfield building on it. Shoreham is quite an easy landmark to find because of the shape of the estuary and the river leading into the channel. We do have quite a bit of autogen loading in as we travel along here, but it's looking really realistic, it's looking really good. And you can imagine at night time, basically the lights from the roads and the buildings would make it quite an interesting view. Seaford is just ahead of us. Dungeness is the point that you should be able to see by now. And we are going to kind of cut across the landmass here. We're not going to go down to the point. But we can look in at Shoreham here and we can see a Fry runway structure set up, which is looking really quite nice. Now we are feet wet, but we're staying very much in view of land, so at 3,000 feet we should be having no difficulty in making it back to terra firma. Wow, that's looking really, really quite nice. Quite impressed here. Now inside here we do have flood lighting, front and rear, and we do have a night lighting switch as well. If I click this red switch, we get this red hue effect, which is obviously a night light. Red is often referred to as the color to use if you want to protect your night vision. You don't want to use white lights or blue lights. You stick with a red hue light and it'll illuminate without causing you to lose your night vision. And I think that's a real thing. And a bit of a kind of a significant flash change there with the water. Now, another compromise that I've made for the simulation is the water. Water tends to be a pretty demanding resource hog, and so the water is not necessarily going to look so awesome in my videos. And that's just the way it is until I work out how to perhaps improve things on the waterfront. I think I'll leave it as it is. It's looking quite soupy and quite ugly, to be honest with you, at the moment. But maybe in later videos I'll work out a way to improve that some. Anyway, that little course correction has brought us quite nicely back on track here. We're 16 and 1700 feet minimums because of the terrain below us. We're up at 2900 feet, so we're feeling okay, comfortable and happy about that. At 12 nautical miles away from Seaford, I've just worked out SF will be, SFD will be Seaford, VOR and DME. We will be, we're doing quite well. Seaford is just in front of us, and this is all making sense. Gosh, that water is terrible looking, isn't it? We'll have to do something about that. But not this time. It could be that I've got some kind of a texture conflict going on between the default water coloring and maybe the water coloring that I've set in some of the other programs. So we'll have to get in and have a gawk at what's going on there, because I don't think I can really stomach this watercolor. Reading is bad. Get back in over land as quickly as we can. Sun is dipping down though. It's 4 o'clock and or 20 past, so we are losing the daylight. We're also running in windowed mode, which is another compromise that I've made for the purpose of just getting on and flying. And I'd rather go full screen. The window is practically the full screen size. We just have that border up there, which it's a pity. There is a borderless option for windowed mode as well, which maybe I will do a test on later and see if that is stable. Still leave us with the menu, of course, but we could hide that, I suppose. So then we would run in windowed mode that would look full screen. But right now, don't look at the very top edge. Now you have. I said don't look at the very top edge, and you won't see the menu and the stuff in there. Right, we'll have a little bit of a left turn coming up in a couple of minutes now, where we'll be swinging over to Lim, and then we'll be looking for our airfield. Seawater is all the same color. That's really bad, isn't it? Never mind. I'm not going to chase that needle or anything now. Seaford is just in front of us. Or just below us, actually, and in front of us. But we're right on it. So we'll get down close to zero. And then we'll switch over. Now, Lim is around the headland and back up. And that headland is a bit of a soft, muddy headland as well, so it'll extend out into the water quite a bit at low tide. Dangerous old place to be, I would think. 4 nautical miles as we go over Seaford right now. Altitude is holding steady, fuel is holding steady, engine manifold pressure is good. Nothing's changed there. And keep an eye on that from to indicator on the HSI. Because I would think any second now it's going to flip. Seaford is just in front of our left, our right wing now. And we're going to be heading up towards Dover and Folkestone. Which means we'll be taking a little bit of a left turn here to track up the coast. Right, Seaford is now just off of our right wing, so we're a little bit away from the VOR DME, and that needle is going to flip over, that arrow is going to flip over pretty much. I'd expect it to flip over within the next 10 or 15 seconds. And there it goes. So we were a nautical mile away from the apparent center of it as much as we can, and that number is already starting to increase. So we'll switch over to our next location, which is 31.1 away. So this 65, I'm kind of not sure what that is. Um, 75 was there, that's 70. So we'll be a little bit closer to the 65 mark now. Of course we have traveled that much further along the coast, so that makes sense. And now we turn onto track. Now I am going to have to interrupt the view once more just to take another quick snap look at the map. Or maybe I won't, I'm not sure. There's an Oxbow Lake around here somewhere, and that's an in-joke for anybody in 54 Squadron who happens to watch this video this far. Right, ugly water is going to have to get... It's jarring me now a little bit, that watercolour. And it is fixable, it's just totally my fault. In the evening time, that should be a slate dark navy or grey, I suppose, under the cloud here. 27 nautical miles to track along, and we're looking okay. Nav2 radio, we're not really bothered about it all that much now. It's done its job for us quite nicely. And then you can navigate your way anywhere you like with these VORs, and DMEs will just help you in terms of distance. And they're very helpful, but you don't need the DME. You should be able to dead reckon your location with your watch and a knowledge of your aircraft's performance. All straightforward and relatively easy to do. Have I got my headlands mixed up again? Do you know I have? What I called Wilmington way back over there is Selseyville. We've just passed over Wilmington right now, here. Yes, of course we have. Dungeness is still ahead of us. Brighton and everything is in front of us. I'm making the same mistake as I have made 100 times when flying the World War II server. Don't know. Mental block. Unable to keep those things straight. Selsey-Bill, headland by the Isle of Wight. Wilmington is the headland that we can't see anymore, but it's just out behind us there. And then we have a little bit of a bump of a headland here, which is not what I'm talking about. In the very far distance, there's another headland, and that is Dungeness. And I should have recognized that sooner. I always end up realizing it on my own and correcting it. But not before I've made the mistake. Of course, I have to make the mistake to correct it, but I still call it out and make the mistake. It's just a thing. It's the way it is. Little bit of a course correction in here because we are drifting south, and I know I want to stay on the headland here, and I know where Lim is. Lim is around the near little butt of rock there, and if you can imagine the bay, if you were to call that a bay, it's much bigger than that. Lim is about a third of the way in, kind of directly on the nose now. So that's where we're going. As a navigation point, and then we're going to land on the other side of it. And we are a little bit south of our track, which is okay. We'll just keep an eye on that, and maybe it'll come in slightly as we proceed. Everything is looking good. Outside air temperature is still showing as a little bit on the negative. We haven't done a carb heat for a while, so bring the carb heat out at the bottom of the hour and leave it for a minute and a half. Make sure any ice has gone off. I'm going to have to do a little bit of research to find out what this TD in 16.1 is referring to. It is a countdown and it is a distance. The question is, it's a distance of what? And the answer is, I don't know. To type in, I need to get a ready reckoner here. 20 nautical miles in kilometers is about 20 knots is just a little bit, it's 37 kilometers. That's showing 60, so I don't know, and we will find out in the future, but we're not going to find out now. I'm going to put in one little bit more of a course correction here. Just chasing that needle a little bit. We're not flying in a very straight line, but just going to offset that because we do have a little bit of a wind component, I'm pretty sure. We're not picking up local latest or weather information. We're not doing anything like that. We're flying by our eyeballs and trying not to look that way because of the sea's color. And we're just going to track in here at 16 nautical miles. Lim is just in front of us. Not too shabby at all. And this is where I'm going to interrupt things for a moment. Set our camera up so I don't have to interrupt it again. And we're going to go here and take a picture. And we're taking a picture, namely, of our last little section of travel. Back in and flying. Doing this so that we understand, you know, what we've got to do. We have a little bit of a distance to go still, but it's not too bad. While the shot is over Dover, this is Dungeness out here. It's a mud headland. Folkestone is in that next bay area. Deal is actually all the way out onto the east coast. You have St. Margaret's out there in the corner. The corner being the southeast corner of the country. Getting lots of messages coming in all of a sudden. Is not deviating too much. I'm happy to stay on this for now. 11 nautical miles will, yeah, that'll get us past Dungeness. Limb is just up around. If you were to track the course down around the end of that headland and come back up on the east side of it, Limb is just in front of us. So we're doing fine. Fuel-wise, we're doing fine. Jesus, I left the carbine on all that time. No harm. But there's no ice there for sure now. T's and P's, as the cool people say, temperatures and pressures are all looking good. Engine speeds, or airspeed indicated, is all looking fairly good. Altitude is nice and stable. Of course, we're on the old autopilot altitude hold here. Quite liking this little autopilot, actually. She be a nice one. Nice. So there is Dover, so we can actually put in Dover at 114.95, and that will track us in over Valdershire, or whatever it's called. 114.95. Go. See, will that pick up? That should be D, V, and R. If we set our course needle onto that, it's going to come in at about... should start coming in before I get to 6, and it does. That's good. So we can use that to get in. And that's because I've just looked at the map here on my phone that I did. Alright, we have enough of you now. And that tells me what I was hoping to find out. How do we navigate there? And there was a VOR over there. That is perfect for the purpose of bringing us into Dover, which is good news. Didn't know there was an airport down there. Airports all over the place. This whole section of area here was pretty lacking in terms of areas to land, I recall. Got a couple on the coast with Hawkinge and Lim and another one as well, the name of which I don't recall for some reason now. But anyway. So our HSI needle is going to start drifting off. We're 2 nautical miles away, so I'm not going to trust that anymore. But we can switch over, and I'll do that straight away now. We can switch over here. We've got our 2 arrow clicking in, and it's pretty much on the same track that we're traveling right now. So we'll stay doing that. It is a DME as well, so we have 21 more nautical miles to go, and that is not too... that's not too bad. That's not too bad at all. That fits. So actually it's going to be dark enough. The sea is looking a hell of a lot better now. That sun going down did soup it up a little bit, but it's actually getting into its grayer color, at least through the back window there, which is nice. A bit of an improvement on aspects prior. But I'm quite liking this imagery out the window. Quite liking the scenery load that's kicking in as well. It's all coming along quite nicely. And this is our second leg on our catch up with Phil. We've done 2 legs. Or we will have completed, if I do this, we'll have completed 2 legs in 2017. On that count, we won't be getting to New Zealand with this aircraft for many years to come. But we'll be upping the frequency, I suppose, a little bit, and we'll get some other flights in. Whenever we catch up with Phil, I don't know. We'll never catch up with Phil, that's the truth of the matter, but we will be tracking down. The goal has been set and it will be achieved, just not in a very timely fashion. As we go right now. We have that TD number counting down from 64 as well, so... kind of trying to work out if that's something else. I don't know. Back to the books, I think, to work out what's going on there. We do have some lights out there in the distance. They're pretty high. I'm thinking that there might be going to be stars. I'm not sure what they are. They could be aircraft, I suppose, could they? Are they moving? Lights up there, can't be stars kicking in, can they? The sun is going down there, and there's lights dotted around the horizon everywhere. That's the sun behind us. Definitely stars up in the sky there, there's a little bit of blue kicking in. 15 nautical miles, so we'll be looking out for the old whatchacallit now. We're passing over Folkestone in a moment, or we might be passing over Folkestone as we speak here. Just underneath us, and then Dover is going to be a little bit further out. The white cliffs of, which won't show up as white here. And then we'll have, we'll have Hawkins in here. I don't know where this runway is, to be honest with you. But we won't have to travel a full 13 nautical miles to reach it, he says. The measure of confidence that should be laced with a good measure of skepticism. Sticking his head out, and I think the runway is just below us. Yeah, I think it's just below us. So we don't actually need to go the whole way over to Dover. So, right, we have our lights on. We are going to disengage our altitude hold. Aircraft is trimmed a little bit off. We are going to turn off our autopilot. And we are going to increase our mixture. And we're going to have a look to see if that's an airport below us. It does have the look of an airport. We're just going to do a little bit of a fly around. What we'll do now is we will stick on our lights, because we are intending to land. We're going to shine up everything from that perspective. Look at the map once more. The airport should be still out there. I don't think that this is the airport we want to go into here. I'm not even sure if it is an airport. It's right underneath us, and it might be a train station or something, isn't it? I don't think that's an airport. It's a road. What places are we going to be landing on a road for? We'll carry on over to Dover here. I think the airport that we're intending to fly to is still a little bit ahead of us. We've dropped a couple of hundred feet here as we've tacked on, but that's not an airport anyway. Whatever the blazes you call it, you don't call it an airport. But we're still geared up for making a landing anyway. Airspeed is still nice and sharp. We are descending a couple of hundred feet, so I'll arrest that ever so slightly. That is the harbour there. There's a boat in. Deal is just up around the corner. So somewhere just the other side of that pillar on the cockpit, we should be looking for an airport. Some antennas along here as well, which is the reason why we have to maintain our altitudes. Anybody sees an airport here, shout out, will you? Which is a bit silly because I won't be able to hear you. Now I do know where I can land if all goes wrong. Pegwell Bay is just up there. Manston and Ramsgate are up there. We have plenty of fuel, and it's actually not that far to fly up there. And that's possibly what I'm already deciding we're going to do if I don't pick up on this airport here anytime soon. And to be honest with you, I don't think I'm going to pick up on it. I'm either flying over it such that I can't see it, or it's in front of us in a... Oh, is that... No, that's not it there. That's just a housing development. Well, there is an airport here somewhere. It's just not making itself noticeably available to us. There's the harbour for sure. There's a boat in the harbour. St. Margaret's Deal is up here on the corner. I think we'll go up to Ramsgate or up to Manston. It isn't very far, and I think it's the right way to go. We'll leave our lights on anyway because we've turned them on. It's not going to make a lick of difference in terms of our next trip flight over. We have Canterbury out there somewhere as well, which was a regular alternative for us when we were flying. But I think we'll just we'll turn out over Deal here. This is Deal on the coast. A location that we've made use of a great number of times. Again, back in IL2 Cliffs of Dover days. We've passed, obviously, over Dover. We're kind of ignoring the radio now. We don't need it. Just trimming the aircraft a little bit. Still nose down a little bit, and I want to maintain the altitude. Well, we can definitely see a runway up there of Manston, that is, with that orientation. Ramsgate is further out onto the headland. And behind me, CI, no aircraft at all. Okay. Well, I'd already made the decision to fly up here, so we'll carry on. And we'll land in the orientation we took off from. We'll assume that everything is blue tickety and no drama. Quite liking the textures out here at night, actually. It is interesting that the light from the landing gear does appear to be lighting up the ground behind it. Yeah! That's crazy! But that's okay. Sun is sinking down behind that western horizon. We're going to track out here, kind of like in the direction of Herne Bay up here, East Church over there, as we'd call it, and we're looking at the runway approach lights as they come in, so get ourselves fairly well out here to the west, and then we'll make a right wing down turn as we come back in onto Manston for a full stop landing. It might be actually a little bit darker by the time we do make that turn, which will be interesting. Gives me a reason to turn on the old nightlight and do a test of that. Another thing we can do is we can up the lighting on our display panel to just a minimum. See if that's causing us any negative effect on our performance, which I don't believe it is. Right, I had moved the throttle position a little bit, that's why it's showing down as 20. But that's okay, we're not needing to speed up, we'll be slowing down a little bit as we get up onto an approach. So we're going to move out to the west, then make a right wing down turn onto the runway, and then bring her in and land her. Autopilot is off, hands off stick. She's fairly decently trimmed. This aircraft is relatively easy to trim. We'll have to adjust trim for our approach once we put in our flaps and once we put in our gear. And it has gotten quite dark indeed, which is quite nice, but performance is holding up okay. Still got a bit of steam coming out of whatever that electricity generation power plant, whatever you want to call it, is. And what I think we'll do is we'll make a turn over this road and use that as a line in for the runway. So now, going to take power out, trimming the aircraft a little bit for nose up as we do that, and taking back the stick a little bit, waiting for the zero speeds to drop off. There's a note down here, max gear down at 150. We're 140 right now, so I'll put in a degree of flap, and we will trim up to counteract that. and we're going to drop gear. Full rich, full prop in. And we'll add in some more power now. As we come in for our turn, we've got greens for our gear. More flap. Airspeed is 110. It's healthy enough. I don't really want to go much more. Keeping an eye on our runway as we try and turn in for it. More nose down now needed. I think I over trimmed. Ball is looking fairly good. We're doing a gentle turn on visually. Altitude at 2,000 feet, so we are a bit high. Trimming back down a little bit here. Taking the speed out a little bit and let ourselves, it's 500 feet a minute, which is it's a fairly standard, between 5 and 8, it's a fairly standard descent rate for these aircraft. We haven't set QNH or anything, so I'm not really going to fly the dials. I'm going to fly the outside view. Just bring the aircraft in fully visually. But looking at the dials, our descent rate is about 800, 700, might have been up in 850, 900 there. It's not too bad. Our airspeed is good. We're lining up for an approach here, full flaps. I've actually had my full flaps down already, okay. Prop is set, gear is down, which mixture lights are on. And airspeed is healthy. We can actually drop our airspeed as we come down. I'm going to trim up a little bit more now. So our descent rate has been enough. Airspeed is coming down. We're taking more power out, and we are a little bit north of our track. And a little bit high if we look at the Pappy lights. So we're just going to slip her in a little bit more and see if we can pick up a couple of those Pappies, at least one of those Pappies. We're still too high. Glide slope should be kicking in around about, kind of gut feeling telling me that I'm going to get some red lights coming in around about now. These. There's the first one. Let's see if we get a second one as we... I'm just looking at those Pappy lights in my peripheral vision now. I'm not really studying them too much. I do have a second one, so we are actually on a glide slope here that's useful. Got a little bit of a kick. That is a little bit normal. I'm just going to fly the runway now. That's all I want to do. Watch those lights coming in, and we're just going to put her sitting down nice and gently, I hope. There it is. Nose wheel down. And we are landed. Fair amount of right rudder in there. Off a little bit of that. Alrighty. Welcome to Manston on our second leg of our catch up with Phil. Ultimate destination is somewhere in New Zealand, of all places. Which I don't even know we'll be able to do, but we're going to try. And we'll exit off the runway down here a little bit now in a minute. trim out a little bit of that so I don't do too much fouling on the plugs. And we're going to go the whole way down to the end of the runway. It seems to drop off. I don't know what's in there. I think it's all tarmac by the looks of things. But we are going to follow our way around. Still make it work. There is a parking space down there. I'm going to head over towards the buildings here. Try and get some centerline pride going on here. Right, leg two done, and we are down borderline VFR conditions, I suppose, but we are down. We're going to turn off the strobe because we've left the runway. We'll leave our landing lights on. And we have a few aircraft packed up here. We need to see where the fuel station is. I don't know where it is, but we'll carry on the way down here anyway. Some helicopters there and some aircraft. And they're on the grass, so let's slow down and bring it in over this direction here. We'll be able to get out and turn the aircraft around ourselves. We stopped. That'll do for now. We'll pull the brake on that. Turn off our landing lights. Turn off our navigation lights. Pull our mixture. Kill the engine. Turn off all of our avionics, master switch, and lights. Actually, I forgot to turn that light off, but we'll turn that off there. And then we can open the door, and out we get. Thanks, folks, for watching. Until the next time, go handy.